Good morning. Miss Tammy says we're willing to do favorites as long as you do it out of the faith we sing. And the first one is going to be 2164, Sanctuary.
Thank you. Good and all the time. Okay. Well, I want to welcome you for the opportunity to worship and praise the Lord, knowing that we've all been made in, in God's image, and knowing that God desires a relationship with us that is real, that is personal, and what a blessing to know that, and I pray that each and everyone feels that. At this time, are there any announcements or joys or prayer concerns?
It's Remy Dale's 9th birthday today.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, Remy.
You're 9 years old, right? All right. That's awesome.
I just want to say, I appreciate the carpets. They're really looking nice this morning. Thank you all.
Yes, it does look nice. It does look nice. Are there any other announcements?
Look like he was wanting to get.
I just want to give you an update on Aunt Dora. Jody says that Dora was able to be up in a chair and walk with a little assistance yesterday, and she's happily watching some of her favorite TV shows. There's still no word as to when she'll be coming home, but she is getting better.
Okay. Please keep Dora in your thoughts and prayers. Sylvia also called me and told me that she's doing better each day, and her daughter Marie has made it through surgery, and she's in no more pain. She'll probably be able to go home in a day or two, but just keep them in your thoughts and prayers if you would, please. Are there any others?
I just want to thank you for the prayers for my brother. He's doing better, so thank you.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
That's good. Good news. Deb's brother is doing better, and just continually lift him up in your thoughts and prayers. If you look at on the back of your bulletin, there is quite a few things that are going on. And 2 o'clock at Prairie West Devotion, and I know Janice would invite any help because I'm not going to be there. I'm going to a spiritual retreat called Rebooting Your Soul. I'll be there in Wichita for 2.5 days, and looking forward to that. And but yes, one thing you'll notice, next week we have a covered dish dinner, and it says guest speaker Reverend Dr. Dustin Petz. He'll only be talking about 6-7 minutes during the service, but he'll be also sharing during the covered dish dinner. He is from Kansas Foundation, and he'll be talking about things that our church can do and also that you can do individually. But I want to let you know one reason the finance and the stewardship team wanted us to get together is we're doing fairly well financially. And want to know if you have any ideas, maybe different things that we can do. And so they're going to ask you for your direction and guidance. And I want to let you know that. Normally, you say, oh, why are they calling us? Well, we're doing well, so we want to know and have some ideas from you, what you like to see. It may be painting rooms. It may be carpet. I don't know. I'm getting a few head nods, so that must be true. I don't know. And so anyway, just wanted to let you know that. And that will be this coming Sunday. We'll have we have a speaker for Holy Week, and looking forward to all that. We'll be getting that out to you probably next week, as far as that little brochure that came in on email. So we'll be looking at that, and just all kinds of exciting things going on.
Pastor?
Yes.
We just wanted to point out that we have Mr. and Mrs. Craig and Kayla Clark here for the first time as a married couple.
Yeah. When they came in the door, I said, "Hello, Clarks," and both of them didn't look at me funny or anything. So they've been working on it for 8 days, so they're getting it down. All right.
Also, Pastor, at the Methodist men's breakfast this morning, we kind of made a tentative decision to go ahead and have a pancake meal on some Saturday in September. We're looking at September 10th right now, but it's in the future that we're going to go ahead and try to have the pancake deal.
All I have to do is leave a meeting and you guys do something.
No.
To Remy's? Okay. Yeah, we can sing. Are you ready for that, Remy? Sure. All right. Wow, here we go.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Remy. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you, Deb, for... And Remy, thanks for smiling. You did well. You did well. Later on, when you get older, you won't smile so much. But right now, it's still a good thing. It's still a good thing. All right. Are there any other announcements? Okay. Well, if not, let us center ourselves, and then we'll have a time to greet one another. I'm going to ask you to... bow your heads and open up your hands, your hearts, and your minds. Good morning, Lord. We thank you and praise you for this beautiful spring day. Dear Lord, this is the first day of spring, and we're just reminded of all the new that is coming on. But one thing isn't new is your love for us. You have always loved us, and you always will. Dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you for who you are. Dear Lord, you are a redeemer, you are a rock, you are our salvation. But many times, dear Lord, I can't speak for anyone else, but I can speak for myself. My focus isn't always on you, even though you are so worthy. Many times my focus, or I'm holding on or carrying maybe anxiety, brokenness, and hurt, busyness. But dear Lord, we weren't meant to carry it. 700 times in your word you tell us to come to you. So dear Lord, I just pray that we'd all allow the Holy Spirit to work in our lives, loosen the grips of things we're so tightly holding on to, that we truly surrender. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is not limited as we lay it at the foot of the cross. Dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you. Dear Lord, now we have empty open hands. Receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We have empty open hands. Receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference wherever we go, that we can give that love, that grace, that mercy, that forgiveness that we have received from you, that we have freely received from you, that we would give to others. I also pray if there's anyone who needs a special touch today, that you would touch them. We just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, all of God's people say, amen. Well, at this time, let us greet one another, please. It was good to see them both, and Dorothy Thomas and Ray Brady, and they're at the Presbyterian Manor, and it was a blessing to see them, and we just want to keep them in our thoughts and prayers. And also Donna Davis fell and had stitches, but she's back home, and she always says wave at her, so we're waving at you, Donna, but I just want to lift that up.
Well, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please join me in the call to worship. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary.
Behold your power and glory.
Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you.
So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name.
Gracious God, we just thank you and praise you. You're such a loving God. And dear Lord, what a blessing it is to be able to come to your throne room of grace by the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Gracious God, we want to lift up Dorothy and Ray, and we pray for continual recovery and continually to strengthen them. Dear Lord, we thank you that Sylvia is getting stronger each day. And dear Lord, that Marie, after the surgery, she is pain-free, and we just thank you and praise you for that. Dear Lord, we thank you that Deb's brother is doing better, and we pray for continual healing for him. Dear Lord, our community has been hit rather hard, dear Lord, with deaths, and dear Lord, we just want to lift up their families, and knowing, as you tell us in James chapter 4, verse 8, as we draw near to you, you draw near to us. Dear Lord, just minister to each and every heart that is hurting, that is broken, that they'd feel your presence and love in their time of grief. And we pray for continual recovery for Donna Davis, and just minister to her also. Dear Lord, we pray for our community. Dear Lord, we just pray that you continue to strengthen us. Dear Lord, we pray for moisture. We desperately need moisture. We thank you for the moisture that we have received and for the promise of more moisture that is coming. We thank you and praise you for that. Dear Lord, I want to lift up our country, our world. Dear Lord, I want to lift up those in Ukraine. Dear Lord, we also lift up Putin, dear Lord. We pray for your will. We pray for your direction. We pray for your guidance, knowing that you can do all things, that you are not limited. And dear Lord, we pray for hearts to change. Dear Lord, we thank you and praise you that we can always come to you. We thank you for birthdays like Remy. And dear Lord, what a blessing that is. We thank you for marriages, and dear Lord, just continue to minister to each and every heart. And I pray, dear Lord, that if there's anyone in this community that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, dear Lord, that they would feel that tugging on their heart, to know that you love them, know that you desire to restore them. And dear Lord, that we know that you also can use us, that we would share the gospel, that we would share of your love and grace and mercy. I just thank you and praise you for all of these things. Dear Lord, thank you for first loving us. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now at this time, if your cup is standing, I'm going to ask you to stand as we sing Nothing But the Blood, number 362. And the hymnal are up on the screen.
Oh, that makes me my master.
may be seated now. How are you guys doing today? Good. You ready for school? No? Yes? Yes? No. Well, it's about half and half. But you know what? I think you get to go anyway, all right? Okay. All right. Was that kind of a trick question? Yeah. All right. Actually, I'm going to be talking about how different people try to trick Jesus. I mean, there was groups that normally didn't even talk to each other, didn't even care for each other, but they wanted to get rid of Jesus because they were afraid they might lose their power or their positions. Can you believe someone would try to trick Jesus? Well, they did. But what do you think Jesus did? What he did was he told them the truth. He knew that they were trying to trick him, but he also told them about taxes, about marriage, about eternal life, about God's love, and how God loves each and every one. Even though they were trying to trick him, right? So I'm not going to give you any more trick questions, okay? But I am going to tell you that God loves each and every one of us. He always has. He always will. And like you said, he wants us to have eternal life. And how do we receive eternal life? Okay, and it is true that we need to follow what our parents tell us. I agree with that. So you might even get an extra cupcake, right? But actually, eternal life is accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior. And it's not just going to heaven when we die, but we have new life right when we accept what Christ has done for us, okay? And that's always good to know that God loves us, all right? God has forgiven us, and that we have that we can have eternal life by receiving that gift. All right, we come to the Lord and we repent. We come back to Him. Instead of focusing on ourselves, we focus on God and God's love. All right, and then we receive that gift of forgiveness, and we become a new person. Right. He starts cleaning us on the inside out. All right. So, should we pray? All right. You guys want to join me with prayer? You want to repeat after me? It's your birthday. You get to make the call. You don't know. Is it your birthday? It's Remy's. What do you think? Sure. Okay. Let's see how we do. Oh, God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiving us. And the hope that we have is in you. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. You guys have a great week. I think the ushers will bring you something, okay? Thank you all very, very much. Thank you. Nothing but the blood, and it is grace alone. So you'll find that in the Faith We Sing, number 2162, or up on the screen. Grace alone.
this time, will the ushers please come forward as we receive the offering? Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this day, for the opportunity to be in ministry with you. Dear Lord, we ask that you would bless this offering we're about to receive. Dear Lord, that it would further a kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, that people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, death, and resurrection. That we serve a risen Lord that has defeated both sin and death. And dear Lord, we thank you again, knowing that you're going to bless this offering, knowing it's going to make a difference. And dear Lord, we also ask that you would bless each and every one that can hear my voice. Dear Lord, bless those that are able to give financially of time, service, and prayer and presence. Minister to each and every heart. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Verses 1 through 8. The authority of Jesus questioned. One day, as he was teaching the people in the temple and telling the good news, the chief priests and the scribes came to the elders and said to him, "Tell us, by what authority are you doing these things? Who is it who gave you this authority?" He answered them, "I will also ask you a question, and you tell me. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" They discussed it with one another, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say, 'Why did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, all the people will stone us, for they are convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it came from. Then Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Roberta. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. I just humbly come before you and ask you for the words. Dear Lord, that they'd be your words, that because your words never return void. We have interpretation, application of your word for our lives. Dear Lord, I just thank you and praise you for this. This minister to each and every heart. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Today we'll be talking about marriage and taxes, and that's why I'm not surprised we're not even in not only the overflow, but also down in the basement. We're so excited to hear about this two subjects. Actually, when I look at the scripture, all these scriptures that we've been talking about during Lent is, who is the king? What is the kingdom? And what is required of his subjects? When we look at the very first part on whose authority that Roberta read to us, Jesus was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel. And we also see from Luke in Luke 21, 37 through 38, that for those Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, each day he was there in the morning teaching and sharing the gospel, the good news. And like we talked to the children, that there's many groups that's coming at Jesus this last week. They're trying to trip him up. They want him to fail so he can even be taken to Pontius Pilate, because they don't want to lose their power. They don't want to lose their authority. They don't want to lose their position. And some of these groups, they would never even work together. They couldn't even agree on anything. But this they can agree on. This they want to get rid of Jesus. So they ask him, on what authority is he preaching and sharing the gospel? The priests, the chief priests, and the scribes with the elders came up and said that to him. Tell us, by what authority do these things? Or who is it that gave you this authority? And it was very common back then that they would ask a question after they received a question. And Jesus said, let me ask you a question. Because this is the first series of questions designed to trap Jesus. Trying to trap him. And then when Jesus asked them, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? What origin did it come from? And they discussed it with one another. And like it was read, if we say from heaven, he will say, why did you not believe him? Because they knew that people would ask, well, why didn't you repent? Because that is what John was saying, to repent, to turn back to God. And John even told them that he couldn't see the fruit, that they weren't repenting, that they were like a brood of vipers. But if they'd say it didn't come from God, that John the Baptist didn't come from God, then they were afraid that they would be stoned. Because the people felt that he was a prophet, which he was. So they answered that they did not know where John came from. And then Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." The next part is about paying taxes. And I know you're excited about that. By April the 18th, we get to pay our taxes if you haven't already had. Or maybe your returns haven't, or maybe you don't even know how much you're going to have to pay yet or receive. There's two groups now, the Pharisees and the Herodians. The Pharisees was a religious group. They believed in the resurrection, and they followed legal traditions that were ascribed not to the Bible, but to the traditions of their fathers. They took the Ten Commandments and made 613 laws out of them. They were the working class movement. Like I said, they believed in afterlife. They believed in the resurrection. But their focus was on the letter of the law than the spirit of the law. And the Herodians, they were a political group. So when it came to asking about taxes, they wanted to know how Jesus would respond. Because if he said, no, one shouldn't pay taxes to Caesar, they would have marched him right across the street to Pontius Pilate. Because during this Passover season, Pontius Pilate would have came from, he was the governor of the southern part of Judea. And it would have cost him his life. Or, if he would have agreed with that, all the Jews would have quit following him. So the Pharisees and the Herodians looked to turn the crowd against Jesus, or turn Jesus over to Pontius Pilate. They sent spies who pretended to be sincere, that they might catch Jesus in something that he'd said, so as to deliver him up to the authority and jurisdiction of the governor, which is Pontius Pilate. They asked, "Is it lawful for us to give tribute to Caesar or not? Is it lawful?" Jesus could see through their deception. So he said, "Show me a denarius, show me a coin. And whose likeness and description does it have?" Whose likeness? It was the image on the denarius was one of the main reasons that the Jews were against this poll tax. It was a violation of the commandment against graven images. It would have been a picture of Caesar. And also on that coin that Caesar is God. Because Caesar pretended to have a position of deity. All the emperors would declare that they were deity, that they were God. The paying of the tax was unlawful worship, the Jewish people would feel. And in their minds of many, it was a gross idolatry. But Jesus said, "Render to Caesar what is Caesar's." Jesus recognized that all citizens have duties to their secular state, as well as duties to God, because we've been made in the image of God, and that we are to give ourselves humbly in obedience to God and God's word. And when they heard this, they didn't have anything else. Next was the Sadducees, and they brought up about marriage and afterlife. You see, the Sadducees were the upper crust of the culture elites. They were in control of the temple. This is where the high priest came from. They felt Jesus was a nobody, a real country bumpkin, if you would. They didn't believe in afterlife, And that's why it's easy to remember when you say, sad you see. If you don't believe there's hope, sad you see. Isn't that true? They only believed in the first five books of the Old Testament, the Torah or the Pentateuch. Jesus taught about resurrection again and again, and he demonstrated it. You know, I believe it, and I'm counting on it. I have to admit, with two funerals just this past week, that not only I believe it, I count on it, but I can encourage others. Yes, they can grieve, but not grieve as without hope. Because if we put our faith and trust in Christ, just like the kid said, we have eternal life. That we do have hope. We do have hope. I said the Sadducees believed in the first five books, but even in the first five books, we know it's about there is eternal life. We know from Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, when Moses was talking to God at the burning bush, God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent to you, because they are still alive, because of eternal life. So they made up this story. They did not believe in eternal life. They did not believe in resurrection. But they said, who does this woman belong to? They made up this story that she married a man. But they didn't have any children, and he passed away. And same with the second brother, the third brother, the fourth brother, the fifth brother, the sixth brother, and the seventh brother. You see, back in Jesus' time, women were no more than property. No more than property. They depended on their father, and if they didn't have a father, they depend on their husband. Or if they didn't have a husband, they depend on their children. But yet, Jesus talks to them and shares with them. Because no one will need a man, God will take care of her. In verses 35 and 36 of chapter 20 in Luke, though marriage is part of God's design for his creation, it will not be a feature of the new creation. So questions like, whose wife will this woman be, are irrelevant. Because the resurrected believers will no longer die. You know, when I think of marriage, I am so blessed to have Betty as my wife, and I love her, but I don't always love her like I should. There's times when she wants to talk with me and wonderful questions, and the Chiefs are playing. I'm doing better, right, Betty? She just learned. She don't talk to me. Her and Barnabas take a nap. Okay, but anyway, kind of. But anyway, every once in a while, you'll see one of their eyes open up. But anyway, God has made it, you know, how much you do love your spouse. But yet, we're still, at times, we can be selfish. But you know, when we get to heaven, that selfishness will no longer be there. That sin will no longer be there. Because we'll be a place where there is no longer sin. And I think we'll have a great love for many. But at this time, you know, when he was talking to those Sadducees, They could only think of what was going on here. And as he shared with them, to say that he was still their God after they had died, it indicated that the dead are raised in verse 37. Existence does not end with a physical death, because we are eternal. Our souls are eternal. And they walked away upset, but yet another group, the Pharisees, were quite happy because they did believe in eternal life. When I think about belonging to God, you probably all have seen this. I've seen it in malls. I've seen it in department stores where a little one gets lost from their parent. And they go up and find someone and they're crying and they have so much fear and they don't know what to do because mom isn't around. And then all of a sudden, the person takes care of them and asks them, who do you belong to? Who's your parent? And then you hear something on the PA, something like, Mrs. Jones, you have something very valuable up front that needs your attention right now. And then you'll see that parent, and all of a sudden you see the parent and the little one, and they just grab them and just squeeze them lovingly, knowing that they belong. Knowing that they belong. And that little one has such peace. Such peace. And no longer afraid. You know, that is the way with God. He wants you to know that you belong to Him. During this Lenten season, you know, my challenge is for you is, every time you wake up in the morning, say, God, I'm yours. You love me. You have forgiven me. You have given me grace. You can direct me by your Holy Spirit. You can guide me. There's a covenant prayer. I'm going to ask you to open up your hymnals to page 607. It's a prayer, so I'm not going to ask you to come play the piano right yet. All right, it's a prayer. Would you please say this with me? I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Put me to be employed by thee or laid aside for thee. Exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. For now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine and I am thine. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, I just thank you and praise you for loving us. And dear Lord, just as that mother picked up that child, took away all that fear, knowing that child knows that I belong. I belong. Dear Lord, I pray that each and every one can say that. I belong to God. God is my Lord. God is my Savior, my Redeemer, my Rock. Dear Lord, I just thank you and praise you for these things. And dear Lord, I pray that each and every one would know you in a personal, in a real way. These things we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Now at this time, we'll have our last hymn, Where He Leads Me. And that's found in hymn number 338. 338. ¶¶ You all, and have a great week.